everybody. Welcome to What's Next, our podcast and blog series about startups and innovation. My name is Giovanni Vaccari. I am head of product here at Startup Bootcamp, but you know that already. And today we will be interviewing our mentor and founder of Finabling, Gregory Crony. He is passionate about fintech, payments, and financial supply chain innovation. Thank you for coming, Gregory.
Thank you for having me, Giovanni.
Nice. I want to ask you to start by asking you to introduce yourself. What is it that you do?
What I do. So I'm Gregory. Currently, professionally, I work as an independent professional consultant. I don't really like the word consultant. I see myself as an enabler.
Cool.
And that's in the field of fintech, payments, and then, as you mentioned, financial supply chain. So last 5 years have been doing that and have been working on many projects in the, even with startups, set up my own startup project in the corporate innovation environment. And I work with other startups mainly on helping them, or setting up payments and billing capabilities, or working with payment startup to improve their value proposition.
And why are you so passionate about these fintech startups in the fintech world?
Why? Good question. I think that goes way back. about 25 years ago when I started working. So I studied, it was called the Financial Academy for Banking and Finance.
Okay.
So I, in that sense, I have a real background in finance, and I've always worked in finance and in treasury. And I've always been a fan of technology. So how does technology support, the treasury and the finance functions, and how can you make, let's say, the financial life easier? And so I think I was doing fintech before the word fintech existed.
Yeah.
And then suddenly fintech, became something and real, and I really liked it. And also what I really like about fintech, and especially nowadays, because let's say in the old days, technical solutions were mostly focused on large corporates.
Mm-hmm.
And so only companies, with big budgets could really implement solutions. Mm. And what I really like about the current trend and about fintech is that it makes, technical solutions available for everyone, either consumers, startups, or SMEs.
Really democratizing it, right?
Yeah. That's something I'm passionate about, yeah.
And you've talked already to quite a lot of founders, right? You've been mentoring founders here at Startup Bootcamp as well,
yeah.
But outside.
Correct.
What do you think are the biggest mistakes that fintech founders make, or founders in general?
Oh, wow. Looking at founders, and maybe specifically in the fintech space, is that they are often passionate about their solution. So
yeah.
Sometimes they forget about who they offer the solution to and what kind of problem they want to solve, and then they become too technical.
And, I get that.
And then, with my background and experience, I try to help them to translate basically what they want to do into, normal speak.
Yeah, because I think it's also the famous quote, right? Fall in love with the problem, not with the solution, because the solution might change.
Correct. Yeah.
And you are also a founder of Finabling. What mistakes have you made?
Oh, what mistakes have I made? I think at hindsight, the biggest mistake maybe was that I started too late.
Yeah.
I mean, I became, I left corporate life about 5 years ago.
Okay.
And before that, I've always worked, with large corporates like PayPal, ING Wholesale Banking, I've worked at Vattenfall. And I've always had an entrepreneurial drive, and also, within my corporate jobs, I always tried to do side projects, but within the context of the employer. And now that I'm independent myself for 5 years, I really like that, and I really love it. And I think in that sense, should have started maybe earlier, but you know, things go as they go.
Yeah, of course. So you can only do this now as well if you have had all these years, right, working in these big corporations as well.
Definitely. And I really learned a lot during my corporate life, and especially also in the last 10 years with ING and with PayPal. Mm-hmm. And I can really apply those lessons and those experiences, and you know, share it with the startups as a mentor, and also apply it in my own business plans. Yeah.
Well, you talk about your own business, Finabling. What are you trying to do with Finabling? What is Finabling hoping to achieve?
Yeah, so Finabling is hoping to achieve, or what I'm trying to do is, and it's kind of a buzzword, you also already mentioned it, is democratize financial knowledge. So what the goal of Finabling is to help startups and SMEs, help them basically manage their finances in an let's say in a good way, in an efficient way, so that they, you know, maybe can postpone the hiring of a financial executive or a financial specialist. And we will do that, you know, by sharing relevant financial knowledge. We have plans about, you know, also launching a podcast, so it's great to be here and learn from how it goes with podcasting. But also think of, you know, paid newsletters, think of how to guide solution directories, courses, all, let's say, different kind of materials that will deliver them their financial knowledge to manage their financial processes, yeah.
Cool. And the Brazilian urban planner, Jaime Lerner, he says that creativity starts when you cut a zero from the budget. So whenever you make the the budget, let's say, a digit smaller. I know you're a fan of bootstrapping. You're bootstrapping Finabling as well.
Yeah, correct. Yeah, because at this point, Finabling is still a side project. So, I mean, my main or most of my time and the main income comes from my consulting work. Mm-hmm. So with my consulting work, I'm basically bootstrapping Finabling. And one of the reasons also to do that is that, I'm already 50 years, I have a family, I started quite late being an entrepreneur. And for me, it's important to really have a balanced life. And what I mean with that is that I'm also passionate about sports and specifically athletics. So I'm also an athletics trainer. So I give trainings 3 days in a week. And, you know, we go to a lot of athletics meets in the weekend. And my two sons also do athletics, so it does cost me quite some time. And I want to be able to balance, let's say, my personal hobbies and passions with my professional work.
Yeah, but that's a good way to keep yourself in check as well, right? Yeah, I mean, you otherwise you get always stuck in the founder spiral, as I like to call it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you see that's very common for startups in fintech?
To bootstrap.
No, to lose track of, you know, and just be obsessed, so obsessed that they lose track of the personal life.
I don't know. It's common, but I've seen some examples. I'm currently also mentoring a startup that is going through this phase because they're so passionate about what they're doing. They really spend a lot of time on the idea and on the product. It's definitely a risk. Yeah.
Nice. And if you could tell something for you, when you started Finabling 5 years ago, you said.
Finabling, I started about a year ago. So the consulting started 5 years ago. Yeah.
But then a year ago, if you could go back in time,
yeah,
what would you like to tell yourself as soon as you started Finabling?
That is funny. And because I think in the beginning, probably spent too much time about also thinking about, okay, how should the website look like and how should we do the branding? All the typical stuff that I also, you know, advise startups, not to spend too much time on it. Even if you then, you know, start yourself, you sometimes step into some of these holes and
It's very interesting because I worked with branding, right, for years. And It is a very difficult thing because as much branding is super important.
Yeah.
But if you do spend too much time worrying about your brand and your branding, especially in the early, like, yeah, it's just a bit of a waste of time because you don't even know who you are.
Yeah, exactly.
Right? If people are going to respond to you, and of course they respond really well to beautiful brands, but you want them to respond to the pain. Yeah. So I think if you're early on, it doesn't mind you if you look a little bit ugly.
Correct.
As long as you're messaging, as long as you're testing and validating your messaging.
Yeah. Yeah, correct. And that is probably also my own pitfall coming from a corporate background.
Yeah, everything is perfect.
Everything is perfect, exactly. Yeah.
And embracing the imperfection of the startup world is a bit of a challenge, but that's where the beauty is, I think, as well.
Yeah.
Right? Whenever you get your first customers that believe in a landing page, you're like, oh, wait, this is really the potential, the power of an idea.
Yeah, correct. Yeah, where you get inquiries through Google search or things like that.
Right. It's crazy how much people really, we always say that if the pain is really there, if you're really solving a bleeding neck and not just a headache for somebody, like people will come, people will find you and there will be a real conversion.
Yeah, yeah. True. Yeah, agree. Fully agree with that. Yeah.
Nice. And for you, what would you like to change in the fintech industry or in the startup industry? Like, I know that you are concerned that startups don't get enough financial help. What do you think needs to change in there?
I think there is a lot of room for, let's say, education. So educating startups and founders about how to manage their finances, for example, and what kind of tools are available and how they can set up and automate processes.
Mm-hmm.
I think especially nowadays, I don't know how familiar you are with the no-code space, but there are so many tools like, for example, Zapier and Integromat.
Oh, yeah.
That can connect, different tools.
No code,
systems.
So you don't need to code anything. Yeah. You can just plug it in and it will do the work for you.
Yeah, and even for MVP creation, those tools are often used. But also from a financial process point of view, you can also use these tools to, create scalable, let's say, back offices or financial back offices.
Oh, I didn't know that. But do you think that that's because people don't know or because they can't afford? Why is that missing?
I think from a startup perspective, founders are, you see it here, of course, in the program and with startup bootcamp as well. Founders are, obsessed by their idea and the problem they want to solve, right?
Yeah.
So usually in the beginning, all of the team members are domain experts or IT or developers, right? Probably the financial person is the last person they want to talk to.
Yeah,
they want to talk to, exactly. But then again, the moment you get traction,
that's the first thing you
growing,
need.
Growing, then you also need scalable financial processes, and that's what we basically want to try and solve and help with. But I think there is a lot of room there for solutions. Yeah.
Yeah, but at the end of the day, cash is king.
Yeah.
And if you're scaling, but also if you want to find investment, how many times have you seen, I see it all the time here, startups that want to do a seed round or a Series A round, and they don't have their forecast in order.
Yeah.
They don't know how much money they actually need to scale.
Exactly. They don't have their financial act together. Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
Or they're just like, yes, we're going to spend this in developing. And you're like, or we're going to spend this hiring a CMO. And you're like, well, shouldn't you also have, to consolidate, you need to have a lot of financial knowledge.
Yeah.
Do you think, though, that the players that are in the industry to help these startups, do you think they're well-equipped enough? Like the people understand the reality of the startups, if you're a financial professional?
Yeah, I mean, this is maybe a risky statement, but I doubt that in a way. Because I think startups go through a lot of different waves, sequences. You really have to be flexible. And I think, let's say, most of these solutions, if they're already there, they really approach it from their own point of view and not from the startup point of view.
Yeah.
And that is something that I want to try and change with Finabling. So really offer, let's say, the knowledge and the solutions from the startup or the founder perspective. So how is it easy for a founder to digest the information?
Yeah, but also based on the reality, right? You're not doing a balance sheet for just an SME or for a huge corporate. You're doing it for a startup that can change like this.
Exactly.
Yeah. And for those who are not seeing the video version, I just snapped my fingers. Can change like this. In your opinion, what is next for fintech?
What is next for fintech? Wow. I mean, fintech is a broad area. I mean, you see it yourself. And if you look at, let's say, all the different backgrounds that startups had in the last batch. But so to pick out one trend maybe, or one thing, is that I think next thing will be open finance / embedded finance.
What is that?
I mean, the last couple of years we have seen or heard a lot, and now we start seeing more about PSD2 and APIs like, you know, payment initiation, account information services to get, you know, account information into personal planning apps, things like that. And next step will be open finance. So it will not only be account information and initiating payments, it really will be about enabling or delivering basically financial products through APIs. So, and then we will get, so that will be open finance. And then I think the next step will be embedded finance. So that you don't sell financial products necessarily through your own channels, but that you sell the financial services where the customers are. So that they really are embedded in, let's say, the journey of the customer. Something also like, you might have heard of it, contextual commerce, right? And you start seeing examples now where you can, you're on Instagram and on somebody's posting something and they market a certain product, and then you can already purchase from Instagram without going to the website, to the shop. I think the same will happen with finance. And then that, so that's what I think is embedded finance.
Nice. Yeah. And for you, what's next for you?
What's next for me? Well, for me, it's really building Finabling out. And so on the short term, it really will be around launching a newsletter. Also, like I mentioned before, starting a podcast. But also, I think on the longer run, we might be able to combine, let's say, sharing of financial knowledge in all these different shapes and forms, also with embedded finance, right? Because if startups or SMEs are digesting our content, why not also then offer, you know, the financial services that or the tools and solutions that they can really implement, let's say, the knowledge that we share with them. And maybe even longer term, I think if we are able to really build up a, let's say, community of founders and SMEs, we can then on the other side also go back to the fintechs and say, hey, if you want to launch a fintech product that is tailored, or you want it to be centered around startups or SMEs, we have a community of startups and SMEs. You can do your product validation and you can do your customer discovery in this pool of companies.
Nice.
So that's the longer term plan.
I want to wrap up with two questions. First, is there anything else you want to say that I haven't covered yet?
I think we did cover a lot.
Yeah.
Maybe one thing I would like to add is that next to being an entrepreneur, since June, I also joined the Applied University of Windesheim as a researcher in the field of financial supply chain and fintech. And that is really great because then you work with, you know, young students. So we help them with, you know, setting up research programs and projects. But then also can apply the learnings, you know, in real time, either, you know, through Finabling, but also in my mentoring work as a...
Sounds like a very gratifying
experience. So, and that's what I like. So I I do enabling, I do consulting, I'm doing research. It's all around the same
athletics.
Topic. Athletics. But from different perspectives. And that's really what I like to do, yeah.
Oh, really cool. And if you had a message for young founders out there who want to become a founder, actually, let's say, what would you like to say for aspiring founders?
Oh, I would say that if I was not born in 1971, but let's say was born 15 years ago. Mm-hmm. So would be 15 now, because I think now with, let's say, all these tools, with the internet, with no-code solutions, it's so easy to start your side project when you're still young, maybe when you're still studying. And that would really be my advice,
Just start.
Do it as a side project. Do it next to your study, next to your job, but start as early as possible. Yeah.
And for mentors, people who want to mentor startups, by the way, a little plug here, Startup Bootcamp is always looking for new mentors. But what would you like to say for somebody that wants to mentor startups?
If they want to mentor startups, then I would say, reach out to Startup Bootcamp or to myself, and I can help with introduction. But I it's really gratifying to do. I really enjoy it. I really like it. I learn a lot myself. Mm-hmm. Even, being in this business for over 25 years, working with the startups, I really still learn new things. And it's very inspiring to work with, young entrepreneurs and, see things from different perspectives. So I would really say they should do it and, step forward and, like I said, contact Startup Bootcamp, or I can help them get the introduction with Startup Bootcamp, yeah.
Nice. If somebody wants to reach you, how can they reach you and Finabling?
Probably the easiest way is maybe via Twitter.
Okay.
At Gregory Crony. So that is very simple. They can also reach out through LinkedIn. I have a profile over there. They can also send an email to Gregory at finabling.co.
Thank you, Gregory, for coming. It was a pleasure having you here.
Yeah. Thank you for having me.
And this was the latest episode of What's Next. We are here every single week, normally on Fridays. Don't forget to subscribe to our podcast everywhere. Great podcasts are streamed, and to follow us on Instagram @StartupBootcamp. We're always posting some news there. Stay tuned for more.